Tech Mahindra Global Chess League has started in Dubai today, guys, and the first match itself was very exciting. It was played between Ganges Tigers and Chingari Gulf Titans. This match was very, very tense, and our very own Viswanathan Anand has scored a huge victory against Duda and Christoph. We'll be looking at this game in this video. Before we go further, I would like to tell you that Ganges Tigers won this match with 10-4 score, and that was really, really cool. Well, of course, Viswanathan Anand played a crucial role, but how you fun who was playing with the Ganges Tigers also won against her opponent, and it helped Ganges Tigers to win the match very comfortably. So we will be going to the game and see how this game proceeded. Before we go further, I would like to say that this Global Chess League is a great thing for chess popularity. I hope that with this Global Chess League, we will be reaching lots of people, and common people who don't know chess, they will also be introduced to chess and they will be the part of the Global Chess League. This is Atul Dahale taking you to the game of Viswanathan Anand. In this game, Vishy Anand was playing with the white pieces. His opponent was Duda and Christoph, and the game started with e4. Well, Anand, we all know this thing, that always likes to play e4. His opponent played e5, knight to f3, knight c6, and now bishop to b5. This is the Ruy Lopez opening, which is being played at this position, and black decided to play knight f6. Of course, there are many other alternatives in this position. For example, a6 is the main line. We all know this thing, that bishop a4, knight f6, and so on. I will not go into the intricacies of this opening, because this is like one of the classical openings. But I'll go to the game. What happened in the game is more important for us. The game proceeded with knight to f6. Then Viswanathan Anand decided to play d3 move. This move is very, very old, I will say. This was played by William Stenis, the first world chess champion, also in his games in the world championship match also. So here, black decided to play bishop to c5, which is a very common idea in this position. Anand decided to capture on c6, then d capture c6. I just want to tell you that in this position, knight captures e5, although it looks like a pawn is free. Is not actually free, because if you capture the pawn, it will be a mistake, because black has a good move, that is queen to d4, attacking the knight on e5 as well as the pawn on f2. And if you save the knight, then you will be checkmated with queen f2. Of course, that's not the case. And if you castle, then queen into e5 will be played. But okay, white has a very interesting move in this position. That move is bishop to e3. Because after you capture here, d4 is another good idea, but black will be getting plenty of pawns, you can say. After this capture, maybe dc5, and then queen captures g2. I think black is quite comfortable and having great position. So, of course, knight captures e5 is not a possibility. Vishy Anand played knight d2, just supporting the knight and getting the knight in the center of the board, you can say. Knight d7 was played in order to save the pawn on e5. Okay, now knight c4, again attacking the pawn on e5. So in this position, black decided to ignore the threat and just castle, because if you go for capture here, again the same idea will be played, that the queen will be coming on d4 square, f2, as well as e5 knight is under attack. So that's not something which is good. So Vishy Anand played just simple move, that is castles. Rook to e8 was played, and now he plays king h1, getting away from all the threats on this diagonal, and maybe in future he will be playing f4. We will see what happens. One thing I would like to say, that if you are new to this channel, don't forget to subscribe to this channel and do like the video, so that we will reach to more people. So I'll continue. Now he played f6, Duda played f6, and now here I thought, when I was looking at the game, I thought like maybe bishop e3 is a very common move, which is kind of okay move, but Vishy Anand was in some kind of a different mood, you can say, in this game, and he decided to play the move that was knight to h4. The idea of knight h4, that it is going towards the f5 square, and this knight, maybe it is coming on e3 square, and then also it will be controlling the f5 square. Okay, so here knight f8 was played. This knight is going towards the king side, you can say. He brought back the knight, because on c4 knight was not doing that great job. Earlier it was attacking the pawn on e5, but now the pawn on e5 is very well protected, so he gets the knight to the e3 square. Knight g6 was played, and now he gets the knight to f5. So a very good square for the knight, I will say. And here black decided finally to give up on his double bishops. He played bishop captures e3, knight captures e3. Of course, bishop captures e3 is not a good idea because black might capture on f5 and the pawn structure, I will say, is not that good. The f5 pawn is a little bit weak and the knight will be getting some attack here. Queen will also be attacking. The rook will be coming and black will be very, very comfortable in this position. So that's why Vishy decided to play knight captures e3 in this position and now bishop to e6. Both players have developed their position and now it's time to develop other pieces which are not developed. For example, from white side, the bishop on c1 is not yet developed. So that's why he played b3 move. And now immediately Duda played queen to d4 attacking the rook on a1 square. So Vishy Anand played rook to b1 preparing for bishop to b2 in this situation. Rook ad8 was played, getting the final piece in the game, you can say. Bishop to b2 attacking the queen. Queen moved back to d6 square and now he plays f3. Well, this is a position which I would like to tell. This is really interesting. Vishy Anand is trying to put all the pawns on the light squares because his dark square bishop is there, which will be free to move everywhere. And one more thing is also there, that it is also called as the color strategy in chess. You try to put the pawns on the opposite color of your bishop. And as you can see, white is having the light square bishop and the light square bishop is also being controlled everywhere. All these squares are kind of controlled by all the light square pawns which white is having. So very interesting setup, I will say, by the pawn structure, you can say. Black decided to create some activity in this position. That's why black played c5. And after c5, Vishy played g3. He is preparing for f4 or maybe h4. This kind of ideas are there so that he can expand on the king side and then get some activity on the king side. Okay, so black is trying to get activity on the queen side. So black continued with b5. Vishy Anand played queen to e2 because c4 was one of the threat. And here rook d7 was played by black. Of course, black is trying to get ready for tripling the rooks maybe on this side of the board. Or if it's needed, the rook can be like brought on the f-file and there also be some kind of interesting possibilities might be there. So Anand also prepares for all these kind of things. He plays rook to f2, indirectly preparing for rook f1 if it's needed. And also the square on d2 square is also controlled by this queen and the rook on f2 square. Okay, that is the idea. So black decided to play queen to c6, further preparing for c4. He said like, okay, if you want to play there, play it. I will play on the king side. He played h4, then c4 was played. He immediately captured on c4, b capture c4, b capture c4. Black has sacrificed one pawn, you can say, in this position, and he's trying to get some more and more counterplay. He plays queen to c5, putting some pressure on this diagonal, and also this is one of the ideas in the position. So Anand says like, okay, if the rooks are coming there, I need to control the d2 square as well as the d1 square, and I don't want to be there under the fire of this queen. So he plays very calm move, that is rook to f1. Rook d8 was played. Now rook is trying to come on the d2 square. That's why Vishy Anand played bishop to c3, controlling the d2 square in this case. Now queen a3, the pawn on a2 is under attack, but he says like, okay, if you want to take the pawn, you can take the pawn, no problem for me. He plays rook to b3, because the point is, if you capture the a2 pawn in this position, then rook a1 and the queen will be trapped in this case. So of course he doesn't want to play like that. He played queen to a6, going back in this position, and now Vishy continued with his attack on the king side. h5 was played, knight to e7, and now h6, going to break the king side. This is a very ultimate strategy, you can say, while playing the game, where you cannot really create any counterplay in the center or on the queen side. Then you start pushing only one pawn on the king side, and then you get some kind of a play on that side of the board because you ruin your opponent's king side. This is very crucial. Okay, knight to c6 was played in the game, and now he plays rook to e1. Well, then knight d4 comes, bishop captures d4, because knight, who is sitting in the center of the board, controls 8 squares in this position, and it's kind of compulsory for black to capture one of white to capture the knight, because knight is attacking on the rook as well as the queen in this position. So of course the knight should not be there, right? So bishop captures d4. Here of course two options were there. The pawn capture was ultimately, I think, it was a better option, but he decided to keep the control of the d file with the rook. So he plays rook captures d4, h capture g7, and now finally the rook comes on d2 square, and it feels like white is getting some trouble in this position. But Vishy found out a way to create his chances. He plays queen f1, very calm move. He says like, okay, no problem, opponent is trying to attack on me, I need to be defensive for a while. king captures on g7 and now the pawn comes on g4 square, making some room for the queen, you can say, because earlier the h3 square was controlled, now it is not controlled. And also, if knight f5 is played, bishop captures f5, then g captures f5 and the g file be opened up and the king will be under attack. So Vishy is trying to create his own chances. This is very interesting how these top players play and how they create the chances despite playing under very less time, you can say, time pressure. Queen to a5 was played, now this queen needs to come, so he plays queen to g1. King g6. I really did not understand this move. To be honest, I thought like in this position, maybe king h8 was the best option to go away from this queen's file, you can say, and not being under any kind of pressure. But he plays king to g6. That was a little bit surprising for me. And now Vishy plays queen to g3, trying to get the queen over here. And also one very interesting possibility was there that if black captures the pawn on a2, which was actually played in the game, the move here which Vishy prepared was g5. What is really happening? Of course, the king will be under attack. So he captured on g5 trying to get some shelter. But now queen captures e5, attacking the bishop on e6 square. So bishop needs to be protected. He protects the bishop with queen to a6. And now here in this position, he breaks open the game by playing f4. Of course, the idea is if you capture here, yeah, rook g1 is idea. You are right about that thing. But Vishy had prepared something interesting in this position. Although rook g1 was also satisfactory to win the game, I'll just show you that rook g1, king f7, then rook g7, king to e8. Of course, if you play king f8, it will be a checkmate after this. But the thing is that if king e8 is played, you need to play only one move, which is very good move also in this position, that is knight to d5. And you can say this is... still, black will be having some problem, but Vishy decided not to give any kind of counterplay to black and he played the next move, that was knight to d5. Okay, the idea of knight d5 is like if you capture bishop captures d5, then rook g1 check. Now the king is not having any shelter to go around. If king h6 is played, then queen g7 check, king h5 and queen g5 is a check and mate. And if you play king f7, then also it will lead to a checkmate after rook g7 check, king f8 and queen e7 check and mate. So in this position, after actually rook to g1, Duda decided to resign the game and Vishy scored a perfect victory, you can say, against Duda and Christoph. This was a very crucial game for this match and I hope that Genghis Tigers will continue their lead, or you can say their amazing play in the next matches also. We will be checking out other games also, so stay tuned on this channel. Will be having lots of updates about all the Global Chess League as well as other games also. So guys, we'll be meeting very soon. Till that moment, thank you, take care and love you all.